please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Let's take a look at the action from US market. Wall Street saw a volatile Friday. The Dow dropped over 400 points, its lowest level since November. Major indices saw their January 2016 lows. This after the investors evaluated the possibility of trade war between US and China. Both S&P 500 and NASDAQ posted losses of over 2% by the time markets closed. Wall Street, they're going into correction mode. So are we on the verge of a trade war? Eunice Yoon has been speaking to businessmen in China to understand the impact that Trump's tariffs could have on their economy. She joins us now. Eunice, what are you picking up?
Markets really were jittery, in part because of the uncertainty over where the U.S.-China trade relationship is going. And that uncertainty was being matched here on this side of the world, perhaps nowhere more than where I am right now. I'm in a town called Dongguan, which is essentially where the U.S. trade deficit was born. American companies come to factories like the one I'm in, and then these factories churn out men's shirts, toys, gadgets that are eventually sold to U.S. consumers. And I've been speaking to Chinese factory bosses as well as American executives who source here, and they say they are worried about a major disruption to trade, which could cause a lot of problems to the supply chain here as well as to their businesses. And that really was emphasized again today when the Chinese government imposed tariffs of their own on $3 billion worth of American goods. There were a lot of smaller items that would include nuts, wine, as well as seamless steel pipes. Now, this was really seen as a warning shot and also a somewhat moderate move. And that's because those tariffs were a reaction to the Trump administration's steel and aluminum tariffs from a couple of weeks ago, and not necessarily from President Trump's larger package and announcement that they were going to be preparing more tariffs as well as restrictions.
Thanks a lot for that, Eunice. And she was pointing out China, too, is also preparing to retaliate against the tariffs imposed by the United States. The country has urged the U.S. to pull back the tariffs, saying that it does not want to get into a trade war. However, Beijing has clarified that it is not afraid of what trade war and has identified more than 100 American products that it will impose duties on if the U.S. goes ahead with its tariffs. Agricultural leaders in the United States, meanwhile, are growing in increasingly concerned with a possible trade war and its impacts on everything from pork to wine. Jane Wells tells us how the pork industry in particular would be affected if China were to levy the tariffs. Well, back home, India remains in a wait-and-watch mode over the trade tussle between US and China. Commerce Minister Suresh Prabhu has said that India will respond appropriately if it faces unilateral action by any country. Meanwhile, former RBI Governor Raghuram Rajan has warned that this crisis could derail global economic recovery.
India is a firm believer in a rule-based, transparent, participatory trading system. And to ensure that it happens, it functions properly, we had invited 53 countries and they have again appreciated India's role into doing that. As we are doing it multilaterally, we also do it bilaterally. We honor all our commitments and we live by the letter, not just letter, by the spirit of it. If any countries take any unilateral action, we'll definitely have taken note of it and will deal with it appropriately.
There are very worrisome scenarios here, so I think we should not take this lightly. I do hope that better sense sort of prevails and we move off from a full-fledged, process of one country doing it and the other country reacting and so on. I don't want to use the word trade war. I don't think we are there yet. But I do think that it's very important that we stay away because it could harm the current recovery, which has been beneficial all over the world significantly.
Well, BJP has avenged its defeat in Uttar Pradesh by poll elections. The party won 9 out of 10 Rajya Sabha seats in the state, defeating the SP-BSP combined in a cliffhanger of a contest. The winner Anil Agrawal defeated Mayawati's candidate Bhimrao Ambedkar in a race that went down to the wire. Pranshu Mishra is standing by to analyze all the action for us. Pranshu, what do you make of this victory?
Well, it's a case where the BSP might have failed to win the seat, but the spirit of alliance, the SP-BSP alliance, that has survived. And the fact, the important observation clearly is that though the BSP never had those required numbers to win the Rajya Sabha seat on its own strength, despite that, it got the entire support from the Samajwadi Party ranks as well as the Congress Party. In fact, Samajwadi Party and Congress both have stood entirely to the commitment which they had made to the Bahujan Samaj Party, to Mayawati, and I think that should be a reason to celebrate or a reason of solace for Mayawati. BJP, on the other hand, will clearly try to project this victory as something of a betrayal on part of Samajwadi Party as far as BSP is concerned, and that's what the line which both Yogi Adityanath, the Chief Minister, and other BJP leaders are taking. They'll carry on, try to take on this perception or this political campaign on the ground level that there can't be any natural alliance between the Samajwadi Party and the BSP, and also now Congress included in it. But the overall sense which we have gotten both from the BSP, Congress and the Samajwadi Party camp is that Rajya Sabha is an entirely different ball game as compared to the general elections. Defeat in Rajya Sabha elections will probably not have an impact on the plannings of a larger grand alliance against the BJP, which will of course also comprise most likely not only the Samajwadi Party, BSP, but also the Congress and the RLD. So the sense which the Samajwadi Party and the BSP camp are now trying to project is that they might not have won the Rajya Sabha seat, but the spirit of alliance has of course survived.
हृदय से बधाई देता हूं, शुभकामनाएं देता हूं। समाजवादी पार्टी का अवसरवादी चेहरा एक बार पुनः प्रदेश की जनता ने देखा है, कैसे समाजवादी पार्टी दूसरों से ले तो सकती है लेकिन दे नहीं सकती। आदरणीय प्रधानमंत्री जी के मार्गदर्शन में, आदरणीय राष्ट्रीय अध्यक्ष जी के रणनीति में भारतीय जनता पार्टी विजय के अभियान को इसी प्रकार से आगे बढ़ाती रहेगी।
BJP President Amit Shah has written a letter to Andhra Pradesh's Chief Minister Chandrababu Naidu. This comes days after Andhra Pradesh Chief Minister Chandrababu Naidu pulled out the NDA over the demands for a special category status for his state. Shah has criticized Naidu's move and has called it unfortunate and unilateral. Maria Shakil joining us now. Maria, the BJP President not mincing his words there?
Absolutely. He has written a 9-page letter. It's a rather elaborate and exhaustive letter in which he talks about various steps or various grants that have been given by the central government, which is essentially the BJP-led Modi government at the center in the last 5 years, and talks about how there has been no utilization of the funds with regards to the 2,500 crore fund that was sent for the building of the capital city of Amravati, essentially to do with government offices. What Mr. Shah is essentially doing here is that as the BJP looks at expanding its footprint, rather getting a toehold in the state of Andhra Pradesh, because they feel that there is an anti-BJP or anti-center sentiment that is being built by Chandrababu Naidu. So this is an attempt, this is an open letter in which he's talking about how decisions that have been taken by Chandrababu Naidu essentially to pull out of NDA was largely political in nature. It's about political considerations rather than developmental issues at play here. You know, it's a rather, as I've been saying, it's a very, very exhaustive letter. And he talks about how the center in the last 4 years has talked about various feasible projects and has initiated action in it.
Well, after the IT and Law Minister Ravi Shankar Prasad warned Facebook of action for any attempt to influence elections in India, the government has swung into action in the Facebook data breach case. The Electronics and IT Ministry has issued a notice to voter profiling firm Cambridge Analytica, asking the company to respond to allegations of misuse of Facebook data to influence users in India. Cambridge Analytica has been asked to disclose the entities that have used its services in India. The company has also been asked to respond to questions like how it collected user data and how did it use it. After Mark Zuckerberg's apology, Sheryl Sandberg, the second in command at Facebook, has also done the same. The company's stock has seen its market cap wiped out by over $50 billion ever since it was revealed that user data was harvested by a company called Cambridge Analytica. This was allegedly used to influence the US elections won by Donald Trump. In an exclusive interview with CNBC's Julia Bootston, Sheryl Sandberg said that they are open to regulations, but also added that it depends on what type of regulations lawmakers in various countries have in mind. Here's an excerpt of that chat. Well, that was Sheryl Sandberg talking about the data breach. But the main corporate strategy awards were held last evening in Mumbai, and the event considered an elaborate methodology for identifying the most qualified companies in four categories, namely classical, adaptive, shaping, and renewal. While Aisha Motors won the awards in the classical category, Tata Sky took home the honors for the adaptive category. Tata Steel bagged the award in the renewal category, and Bajaj Finance was adjudged the best company in the shaping. The awards were given by Vice President of India, Venkaiah Naidu. And with that, we wrap this edition of Business Saturday. Thank you for watching, but stay tuned. Eye on India is coming up.